Led Zeppelin's 75 US tour contained all the elements they had become notorious for: the groupies, the excess, and regular descent into full-blown chaos. One gig in Boston was even cancelled by the authorities after 1,000 Zeppelin fans ran riot in the lobby of a local arena. Nevertheless, the tour was a gigantic success, with 3 concerts at Madison Square Garden selling out in a record 4 hours. Alongside their gargantuan album sales, Led Zeppelin had, by this stage, also earned a reputation as one of the most exhilarating live bands in history.
We've read stories over the last, a couple of weeks of the riots to get tickets now for Led Zeppelin concerts, and obviously with the demand you're having to play enormous auditoriums. I mean, would you prefer really in many ways to go back to playing smaller gigs, or do you really go off on the bigger ones?
I think it's irrelevant, providing that you can create and establish and maintain an atmosphere, you know, whether it be in a small place or a large place. And we found with America that it can be... We pulled it off with 57,000 people, you know, and that was quite a thing. I mean, it could have been 57,000 people, Led Zeppelin, and no atmosphere, you know, but it seems to work. It seems to be okay.
As a live act, there was an onstage chemistry between the four of them. I mean, you know, there really was. And the other very crucial point is that all their songs played live expanded in a very different way every night. So if you were watching Dazed and Confused on one particular gig, it wasn't going to sound like that the next gig. And that was the beauty of Zeppelin, was the experimentation. Anything can happen. Total spontaneity between four creative musicians that really had a telepathic chemistry, which I think every night, you know, it could go in on, you know, any direction. You never knew what you were going to get at any one time, and that was a creative spark that kept them going and kept the audience coming back.
It was in February 1975, in the midst of their 26-city tour schedule, that Zeppelin's growing ambition was to make its way to vinyl. It had been almost 2 years since the release of Houses of the Holy, and Swansong Records was gearing up for the first album from its premier artist. Physical Graffiti was a double disc set that had already amassed $15 million worth of advance sales. Expectation and anticipation were high, to say the least.
Because it's been quite a long time, Robert, since the last album. Why has it been so long?
We've been involved in a lot of things. We've been coming to a lot of conclusions and decisions and starting the record company off, you know. We also got mixed up in quite a gargantuous film, you know. So all these things lead up to, you know, time is swallowed by every move, you know.
Yeah.
We've had a disappointing album. We've had a fairly long delay in following up that album. I don't think anybody quite knew what to expect in the run-up to Physical Graffiti. Robert Plant talked it up quite preposterously, telling one interviewer that they were creating their equivalent of Beethoven's Fifth Symphony.
Part of the excitement was you never knew what to expect. You didn't know whether they were going to go for a distinctive direction, go all over the place, what were they going to do? And the fact that it was a double album made it even more interesting, because everyone was wondering, how are they going to achieve this? What are they going to do on a double album? This is going to be amazing.
I had no idea it was going to be a double album. I thought we were just going to cut an album. We cut 9 songs. In those days, you'd only get 20 minutes a side on vinyl. It's obviously 10 years before CDs. And 9 songs, especially when you have songs like In My Time of Dying and Kashmir that were so long, you couldn't fit more than that on. I've read some reviews about Physical Graffiti where they think there's some filler in there. And I don't know where they're coming from on this. In those days, before CDs, we could get 20 minutes on a side of an album. So that limits an album to 40 minutes. A double album is 80 minutes. Well, that's about the size of one CD that we have right now. So it certainly wasn't out of the question to have that much music, and especially if I was surprised because I didn't know that they were going for a double album, but I think it all works well.
It was just beautifully sequenced. You know, it had highs and lows, and you traveled that journey with them over four sides, and I think that was what was so good about it. You know, there was a journey to be had with that album, and by the end of it, you were breathless. You know, you'd been part of their world, and it doesn't work like that anymore with CD. I think the fact that it was four vinyls with four very different contexts going on you know, each side made it such a journey. It had every colour of the Zeppelin spectrum, you know, which is what they wanted to achieve with it.
For me, Physical Feature is the best album that Led Zeppelin ever made. For me, it's the greatest album ever made. For me, if you had to choose one album, which is very difficult for Led Zeppelin because they've all got so much to offer, if somebody said you have one album, that would be the one, apart from cheating and taking a box set. If you had to choose just the one, that would be the one, because I think that encompasses everything about Led Zeppelin, from folk to country rock to blues to heaviness to funk and soul. They crossed the spectrum. There's a bit of prog in there as well. So realistically, this was an album that took them across the entire spectrum of what they could do and do brilliantly.
Physical Graffiti inevitably made it to number one on both sides of the Atlantic. From the typically iconic cover featuring St. Mark's Place in Greenwich Village, later to feature in the Rolling Stones video for Waiting on a Friend, to the sheer wealth of material being offered, the album marked a fitting culmination to the band's career so far. Yet, despite it being an undeniable leap forward for Led Zeppelin, a good deal of the album's tracks had been laid down in sessions for previous work. Six of the songs on Graffiti had emerged during the recording of Led Zeppelin 3, Led Zeppelin 4, and Houses of the Holy. To fully examine the origins of Physical Graffiti, it becomes necessary to turn the clock back 5 years to July 1970 and the recording of the band's third album. Led Zeppelin III had been assembled at Island Studios and had garnered mixed reactions due to the group's heavily acoustic leanings. Highly evident on tracks like Friends, Gallows Pole and Tangerine, this acoustic streak would also run through a two-minute oddity that was left off the album. It was a short instrumental called Bron We Are, which would resurface half a decade later, an eclectic addition to side three of Physical Graffiti.
Bronio is a very acoustic, genteel instrumental. It only lasts 2 minutes, 6 seconds. It's the shortest Led Zeppelin studio recording ever released. It was left over from the recordings for Led Zeppelin 3. So it's comparatively quite old. It goes back two, three albums, but never fitted on Led Zeppelin 3. They couldn't find a way of putting it in there, but resurrected it for Physical Graffiti. And it is a funny little interlude. But it's nice to have it there. It's better to have it there than not to have it there. And I think it's appreciated almost as a break and a chance just to sort of relax a little bit for 2 minutes.
I think there was always plans to use it. I mean, in Zeppelin, when they got to an end of album, it got to a point where they thought, oh, we haven't used that, but maybe we should do. And Physical Graffiti was the right time to go back and look at those tracks that hadn't quite make it, you know, made it before. It wasn't a case of the tracks weren't up to scratch. I think it was just the fact that the quality of other tracks, you know, had taken precedence. So I think something like Bron We Are fits into that scope, and it was good to see it eventually used.
While only one track had been left over from Led Zeppelin 3, future sessions would see the band amassing a great deal more material that would find its way onto Physical Graffiti. December 1971 saw work begin on the band's fourth album. Night Flight, the opening track to side four on Physical Graffiti, was recorded during these sessions.
I received a message from my brother across the water. He said, left.
Fight was almost a jam. It's almost as if they're not quite certain when they started out playing the track where it was going to end up. And so it starts off with a very poppy, light feel and then gets a lot harder and tougher. And of course the lyrics are about someone dodging the draft in America, which again is a different sort of proposition for Zeppelin to get involved with lyrically. So it's a bit of a weird track in a way, but again it actually showcases Zeppelin's ability to put different styles on the same song and make them flow.
Also recorded during the fourth album sessions was Boogie With Stu, a track which, when later included on Physical Graffiti, would see Led Zeppelin run into trouble with their songwriting credits.
Stu came about because Ian Stewart, the Rolling Stones keyboard player and tour manager, had come down with the Stones Mobile when Zeppelin were recording Led Zep 4. They recorded and they got into a jam session with him, and it was based around a song called Ooh My Head by Richie Valens.
They'd run into various problems over songwriting credits. And, I think on Boogie With Stu, they wanted to do the right thing.
It caused great controversy because on the songwriting credits, it's got Mrs. Valens down there, Richie Valens' mother. And Jimmy Page legitimised it by saying that he'd heard that she had never got any royalties for her late son's music. He died in 1959 in the crash that also killed Buddy Holly and the Big Bopper. So they gave her a songwriting credit to make her some money. And of course, then they got upset because Richie Valens' estate sued Zeppelin, claiming that they plagiarised the number, which itself had plagiarised Little Richard.
They always wanted to stay close to those roots, and I think that Boogie With Stu is an example of them going back to that 50s vibe. Ooh,
my soul. Zeppelin was a huge rock and roll jukebox when it wanted to be, and that was another thing they could do in the studio, which certainly mirrored itself on that track.
Led Zeppelin would not only be drawing on the influence of 50s rock and rollers. The same fourth album sessions that spawned Night Flight and Boogie With Stu would also produce Down by the Seaside, a piece that had started life as an acoustic number before transforming into something more elaborate. Later placed on side three of Physical Graffiti, the aesthetics of the song, a testament to Robert Plant's love of artists such as Stephen Stills, Joni Mitchell and Neil Young, with many citing the apparent direct inspiration of Young's 1969 recording, Down by the River.
Down by the Seaside is unquestionably inspired by Down by the River by Neil Young. Plant himself was a big fan of Neil Young, Stephen Stills and those sort of performers, the country rock performers, if you will, the formative country rock performers. And there's no question they based Down by the Seaside on Down by the River.